Ladies and gentlemen, good evening, and it's a great joy to be here at St. Anne's Parish in our continuing series in the Christian Culture series of Assumption University. We've moved around this year to different parishes to share the wealth of this wonderful lecture series. And as you know, those of you who have followed the lecture since last fall, we focused on the theme of holiness. Holiness, the call given to each of us, holiness that we share in the lives of the saints, holiness that we experience in one another. This evening we brought an expert in holiness. We brought someone who's very familiar with the saints, because in his very diocese, within a few meters from his residence, are many saints and blesseds. His Eminence, Cardinal Lacroix, was born in 1957. He is a child cardinal, he's a very young one, and a new cardinal as well. A priest in the society, or the Institute, the Pius X Secular Institute. He served in missionary countries before coming back to Quebec. And in Quebec, in a very quick series of moves, is Auxiliary Bishop, then Archbishop of Quebec City, and now named to the College of Cardinals by Pope Francis. This evening he's going to talk about holiness and the saints. Please welcome His Eminence Gérald Cyprien Lacroix, the Cardinal Archbishop of Quebec.
I've been asked tonight to share with you about our country, Canada, a country founded by saints. It's a wonderful topic that I hope we can take the time to discover and to share. Canada has been blessed with great saints, holy men and women that shaped our country. The challenges we face today require that we too become saints. Are you up to the challenge? Is the ultimate question that I hope you will receive and leave with tonight. Before we look at some of the great figures of our Canadian Church, the holy men and women who were instrumental in the foundation and the growth of the Church and of our country, I would like to ask you a few bold and maybe indiscreet questions. By a showing of hands, do any of you here today think that you will become a saint? Okay, thank you. Another question. Are there any of you here tonight who want to become a saint? Okay, thank you. Many of you did not raise your hand at the first question. In fact, most of you did not raise your hand when I asked you if you thought you were to become a saint. Why? Why don't you think you can become a saint? Give me one good reason why you personally don't think you can become a saint. Because you're a sinner. Okay. Another reason why you can't become a saint. We have a sinner on this side of the church. Pardon me? Not worthy.
Sometimes I think it's our personalities that get in the way.
Your personality is getting in the way. Okay. Any others? Yes. Your self-will, okay. Most of you said that you want to become a saint, but I don't want to get to you guys yet. Those who did raise your hand, there were a few of you who said, yes, I think I will become a saint. Why did you answer yes? Why do you think you can become a saint? Yes.
Because in order to go to heaven, you have to be a saint.
You have to be a saint to go to heaven. So it's a good idea to make it. Others who answered, yes, I think I will become a saint. Yes.
I think a saint is a sinner who wants to get better.
A saint is a sinner who wants to go better, get better. Okay. Others? Yes.
Married 48 years. I'm working on it.
That's a good, married 48 years. If you don't become a saint, let me tell you. We will see tonight, and I hope you will leave convinced that you can all become saints, because that is your fundamental calling. That's what we're called to be. You are a great candidate for holiness. In the First Testament, we call it the Old Testament, holiness belongs to God and to God alone. Holy is what God is, His being and His essence. We sing every time at Mass, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory." The Holy One is God, not us. And we probably were taught to look at God as the Holy One, and that is correct. He is holy. So holy that we use the three words, one after the other, to say the same thing. It's like a superlative. He is holy, holy, holy. And then comes Jesus in the New Testament. The Son of God, who is born and enters our human nature, our history, and helps us understand what holiness is and how we are called to be a holy people. God will reveal to us that holiness is not just out there, it's not just God. We are called to live in God's presence and Him in our hearts, in our souls. We are the new temples. In the time of the Jews, what was holy was the temple. That was where the presence of God was. And there was a certain part in the temple that was reserved where no one could go because it was the presence of God, the Holy of Holies. Well, Jesus turns that around and says, now you're the ones who are the holy people of God. He's in you. That's very interesting that we reflect on that. Jesus teaches his disciples that God's standards for holiness are high when compared to what human beings normally accept from themselves. But thanks to God, holiness is possible for us to attain and to attain his standards once we open our hearts and let the Holy Spirit in, and let Him guide us to holiness. And I must say that that is quite a challenge. A few years ago, I remember once when bumper stickers were much in style and were often put on the back bumpers. Remember when we had all those chrome bumpers? It was easy. Now you can't put a bumper sticker because when you take it off, all the plastic comes out. But in those days, in the old days, I saw a very interesting bumper sticker that caught my eye, and it read like this. Maybe you've seen it. God is my co-pilot. That's cute. I thought that was pretty cute. God is my co-pilot. And then I began to think, if God is my co-pilot, who's sitting in the pilot's seat? And that kind of scared me. Who is in charge of my life? Am I the one who decides the road I take, the turns I make, where I go, and how fast I get there? Do I really want God at my side as a co-pilot, just in case I need Him? And yet maybe that is sometimes how we operate. We tell the Lord, let the driving to me. I know where I'm going, and I'll decide what turns to take in my life. Holiness is possible only if we let God take the wheel, the driver's seat, and guide us to where He wants to lead us. Now, that does not mean, understand me well, that does not mean that we are passive passengers in this life, driven to where we do not want to go, hostages taken by force. No, that's not how we live our Christian life. That would not respect the intelligence and the freedom that God has given us to discern and to decide what is best, to decide to follow the road He offers us. You see, if we let God guide our lives, it is because we trust Him. We know He wants what is best for us. He is our Father, our loving Father, that would not lead us astray to a dead end or off the deep end in a cliff. Jesus spends a lot of time, you've noticed, in the gospel, during His public ministry, teaching His disciples and the people He meets who listen to His teaching about His Father, who is full of mercy, who forgives and watches over us and offers us abundant life. That is why we can accept that God be the one who leads our lives. I heard that once. Apparently, this is a true story, that there was once a very turbulent flight between two Canadian cities. A flight that is usually smooth, that day was particularly turbulent. A woman was sitting next to a small boy. As the seatbelt sign went on and the stewardess invited everyone to remain seated, seatbelts fastened, and to keep calm, there was visibly a lot of frightened people on that plane. Going through some very heavy clouds, the jet plane was shaken, tossed in many directions. People were screaming, others were praying, others were white as ghosts. I don't know why they say ghosts are white. Have you ever seen one? Are they really white? I don't know. But that's what we say. The little boy sitting next to that lady kept on playing with his video games on his iPad. Calm as could be, as if he was not noticing what was happening. The lady that sat next to him finally turned to him and said, "Aren't you frightened by this turbulence? How can you keep on playing your video game?" The little boy just looked at her and said, "Well, no, I'm not afraid. My dad is the pilot." That said it all. He wasn't afraid. His dad was in control. What could go wrong? The saints who founded our country did not go through their lives without turbulence. They faced the many challenges of the new world, and yet they were able to sow good seeds that continued to grow and produce abundant fruit in the church and in Canadian society. I'd like to briefly look at a few of our very own blessed and saints. Do you know how many saints we have in Canada? All over the country. How many have been canonized here in Canada? More or less. Who has an idea? Four. Okay. Five.
Eight.
Eight. See, we're moving up there. I hope you're not wrong. Huh? 20. 50. We have right now 14 Canadian saints. 14. The Canadian Jesuit martyrs. Now I'm going to read their names. They're all French names, so I'm not going to try and pronounce them in English. Saint Jean de Brébeuf, Saint Charles Garnier, Saint Gabriel Lallemand, Saint Noël Chabanel, Saint Antoine Daniel, Saint René Goupy, Saint Isaac Jogue, et Saint Jean de la Lande. And then there are two great women with the same first name who worked in Montreal. Saint Marguerite Bourgeois, Saint Marguerite Duville. And then there's a doorkeeper from Montreal, Brother André of Montreal. A young Indian girl born in the state of New York, but who died on the south shore of Montreal, Saint Kateri Tekakwita. Then there's the first bishop of our country, first bishop of Quebec, who's my predecessor, Saint François de Laval, and the first religious nun to come to Canada, Saint Marie de l'Incarnation. Those are the saints, 14. We also have blesseds. Those are those who are on their way to becoming saints. They've got to the first big step. Usually a miracle has been recognized, their life has been studied, all the history, all their writings or their virtues, how they lived, how they love the Lord, how they love people. And the church has said these are blesseds. How many of those do we have in our country? You can try again. You weren't pretty close last time, but I'm giving you a second chance. 50. We've got a generous man here. We got 50. 5. 10. Gee, I'm glad I came to give this talk. I see you need a lot of information on our Canadian saints and blesseds. Well, there were 11 blesseds in Canada until last Sunday, where we added a new one. Now we have 12. Here are their names. Blessed Marie-Catherine de Saint-Augustin. Blessed Dina Bélanger, a pianist. Blessed Marie-Rose du Rocher. Blessed Marie-Léonie Paradis from Sherbrooke. Blessed Louis-Zéphirin Moreau, Bishop of Saint-Hyacinthe. Blessed Frédéric Johnson, a priest of the Franciscan family who worked in Trois-Rivières. Blessed Marie-Anne Blondin. Blessed Émile Travernier-Gamelin. Blessed André Grasset. Blessed Nicetas Budka. Blessed Basil Velichowski. These are two from the church out west, that we call the Ukrainian Church. And the one who was canonized last Sunday in Rimouski, in the province of Quebec, Blessed Elisabeth Turgeon. When you are made aware of this impressive and pretty long list of blesseds and saints, you rapidly discover that our country has been blessed by a great number of holy people that the church has recognized as examples of Christian life and models of holiness. Of course, if we look at other European countries like France, Italy, and Spain, who have almost 2,000 years of history, well, they've got a lot more. Our church is only 400 years old. We're just beginning, and we already have all of these holy people. We are probably one of the only countries in the world that can affirm that we were founded by saints. The first explorers and settlers who came to Nouvelle-France traveled with the explicit intention of evangelizing the New World, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, and living out the missionary mandate left by Jesus to his disciples before ascending into heaven. Go out, go into all the world, and proclaim the good news to the whole creation. The first religious missionaries to come to Nouvelle-France, to what is now Canada, were of the Franciscan family, the Recollets. They arrived in 1615. We're celebrating this year 400 years of their arrival on our continent. They were very active from 1615 to 1629, and then again from 1670 to 1849. Their missions were established principally in Quebec, in Trois-Rivières, in Montreal. The Jesuits had already come to Acadia on the East Coast in 1611, but they preferred at that time not to concentrate their work here, but they went to Latin America, where they worked a lot. The Jesuits came back and officially established themselves and their missionary work in Quebec in 1625. It is according to our divine calling, their founder, Saint Ignatius of Loyola, had written, to travel to various places and to live in any part of the world where there is hope of God's greater service and the help of souls. And in Canada, they were called at that time the Black Robes. Immediately, they began to reach out to the indigenous people in the vast new land. They were sent to the Mi'kmaqs, next to the Montagnais, then to the Algonquins. They followed the wanderers. They made their way into the forests, along the waterways, across the portages, and through the woods. This is absolutely amazing. It's a new way of bringing the gospel to the world. And this will be a trademark, a very important characteristic of our Canadian church, our own way of doing missionary work. Instead of bringing people to us, into our structures, and into our culture, we go to them to try to understand their culture and their history and bring them the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. At first sight, this may seem as natural as can be, but there is something very original and new in this method of evangelization here in Canada that I'd like to point out with you tonight. For in many other countries, the settlers and missionaries transported with themselves their own culture and worked to bring people they were evangelizing into their own world, teaching them the European languages and the expressions of their faith. Most of the Spanish colonies were established like this. I discovered this when I visited a few years ago the Spanish missions in Texas, in the Diocese of San Antonio. The Spanish missionaries and settlers built a little Spanish town surrounded by a protective wall. Inside that wall, there was a church, the homes of the settlers, and they started building on the inside of the wall small homes so that the people that they would meet on the outside and evangelize could come in and live with them, learning to speak Spanish, adopting the Catholic faith with its Gregorian chant in Latin or Greek, and learning to live in little houses. And for most of these people, they had never done that. They were a nomad people. They lived from place to place with their herds. They were not used to living in homes. They had done that for generations. So in many ways, the native people had to abandon their own culture and traditions to adopt the European way of life. Of course, many good and holy people came out of this. However, this is not how we evangelized in Canada. The Jesuits went out to meet the Indian tribes in Canada and did their best to learn their language, learn to participate in their traditions, learn to discover and eat and love their food. And they brought them the beauty of the gospel and the Catholic faith. The best known of the early Jesuit missions turned out to be a heroic failure, a failure of Saint Jean de Brébeuf and his companions in what we call in French la Huronie, Huronia. They had hoped to establish a church there that would be at once fully Catholic and fully Huron. At Saint Marie in 1639, they built a house of prayer and a home of peace, a community where white and Aboriginal people were to dwell together in harmony, where the rites and traditions of both Europeans and Hurons could be strengthened and enriched by the values of the gospel. But their plans got caught up in tribal warfare, in the intrigues of the French and English courts, in the politics of the fur and brandy trades. They were destroyed by those they most wanted to serve. 8 of these Jesuits have been canonized. I mentioned them earlier. And many others, including native friends like Saint Catherine de Caquita, continue to inspire missionaries to our day. Something very important to highlight here, that is a constant concern for the missionaries that brought the gospel to our country 4 centuries ago, and should continue to inspire us today and guide our efforts as we continue to share our Catholic faith. The gospel does not seek to assimilate people into a particular culture, but invites us to encounter Jesus Christ and to decide to follow him, who is the way, the truth, and the life. It is the teaching of the Catholic Church that in every culture there are signs of the breath of the Holy Spirit, God's imprint. We are all created in his image and likeness. The gospel purifies what is not faithful to love and truth in our cultures and brings us to abundant life. There are many beautiful examples in other Canadian saints that allow us to see the respect for the native peoples of Canada. I'd like to share a few thoughts of Saint Marie de l'Incarnation, a cloistered Ursuline nun who came from France and who founded the first girls' school in Quebec, wanted to teach the little Indian girls in their own language. She learned and had her sisters learn the Algonquin, Huron, and Montagnais languages as to better relate with great respect with the children and the families that they taught. She published dictionaries and a catechism in their language. And when she discovered this, I find very interesting. When Marie de l'Incarnation discovered that the little Indian girls did not learn well in the classroom because they've never sat in a closed room to learn, she decided to move her classroom outside under a huge ash tree, and that's where she taught. The little Indian girls learned very much and much better under the tree than in the classroom. Now that is going way out to adapt to someone's culture. Saint Marie de l'Incarnation was not declared a saint because she taught under a tree. But what brought her to do that, we may ask? It was her intensive, permanent relationship, friendship with the Lord. A friendship she cultivated in daily prayer, seeking to live out her life with the attitudes and the mentality of Jesus. meditating the gospel. She admired that page of the gospel where we see Jesus sitting at the well with the Samaritan woman. She was moved to read of Jesus welcoming the little children. She saw in the relationships Jesus entertained with people the immense love and respect, and she strived to do the same in her context, some 1,600 years later, as she became a missionary in Nouvelle-France. The saints, you see, reproduce in their own lives the life of Christ. Saint Paul does not hesitate to affirm, "For me to live is Christ." Of course, we recognize with sadness that in the course of our history, in these four centuries, mistakes have been made and that people have suffered from lack of respect of their culture. We have to be humble enough to recognize that. They have suffered because instead of living out Christ's love for humanity in a spirit of service, we have been unfaithful to the gospel. But that does not tarnish the reputation nor the impressive missionary work of our founding saints. Another wonderful example of holiness is the first bishop of Quebec, François de Laval, another Frenchman, who was trained by the Jesuits in France and by a group of lay spiritual leaders that had a profound missionary spirit and a spirituality that was very revolutionary for the time. François de Laval lived in the aftermath of the Council of Trent, where a more pastoral approach was expected from the ministers of the church. As soon as he arrived in Quebec in 1659, he did not build himself a castle or an impressive residence to live as a prince in a royal court. He lived with a profound spirit of poverty, with simplicity, sharing his daily life with missionary priests and lay missionaries who were, like himself, striving to build this new Canadian church. François de Laval, like the missionaries, the Jesuit missionaries, did not seek to bring people to him. He went out to meet people where they had established their homes, their farms, their small communities, along the great St. Lawrence River. He traveled humbly by canoe, on foot, on snowshoes, to go serve the people of God. He was sometimes gone for months at a time on pastoral visits. As you know, the Diocese of Quebec, at its origin, was the biggest territory in the world, the biggest diocese, geographically speaking, in the world. From the Atlantic coast to the Rocky Mountains, from the Great North to Louisiana and the Spanish colonies of Mexico. Of course, François de Laval was not able to visit the immense territory of his diocese, but he was very preoccupied in preparing priests and missionaries to serve the French settlers and the native peoples. Among some of his most beautiful writings are the words of advice he gives missionaries who are called to tend to the people of the growing church in Canada. Here are a few of the talents that make a good missionary by the standards of Bishop François de Laval. To be filled with the Spirit of God. This Spirit must animate our words and our hearts. The mouth must speak from the abundance of the heart. That makes a good missionary. What else makes a good missionary? To have nothing in our lives or in our morals that may seem to give the lie to what we say or what could indispose the minds and the hearts of those we want to gain for God. What else makes a good missionary? François de Laval says, one must win affection through one's kindness, patience, and charity. And to win over the spirits and the hearts, to gain them for God. Often, a word of bitterness, an impatient gesture, an irksome look will destroy in a moment what had taken a long time to accomplish. Saint François de Laval was a great shepherd, a bishop who was generous in preaching the Word of God and celebrating the sacraments. He was also an avid defender of the rights of the poor and those who were abused by society. One of his most famous battles was the one he courageously led to protect the native peoples from the abuse of the fur traders who exchanged spirits, alcoholic beverages, for their furs. He wanted to defend the native peoples because he saw they were being abused. The bishop was accused of interfering in a matter of commercial policy and suffered greatly as he witnessed the devastating consequences and the abuse by getting the Indians drunk and taking advantage of them. Saints are always attentive and dedicated to defend the poor and those who are not able to defend themselves. We have so many other good examples in Canada. Saint Brother André of Montreal, who spent his life as a doorman, welcoming people and listening to their suffering, complaints, bringing them to look to the Lord and to Saint Joseph for comfort, healing, and forgiveness. Blessed Marie-Catherine de Saint-Augustin, a nun who worked all her life in l'Hôtel Dieu de Québec, treating the sick and praying for them day and night in the poorest of conditions. Blessed Elisabeth Turgeon, who was beatified in Rimouski last Sunday. The founding bishop of Rimouski, Bishop Jean Langevin, invited her to come establish small schools in the little parishes of his diocese of Rimouski. She was already a teacher. She was 35 years old, had taught most of her life in different little communities in the Diocese of Quebec. And so she accepted to go, and she founded the Sisters of the Little Schools, who later became the Sisters of Our Lady of the Holy Rosary. I wish they'd have kept the other name, the Sisters of the Little Schools. It explains their mission. A very inspiring life, and a congregation that has always served the poorest regions of the diocese, where they teach very close to the poorest families, bringing a good Catholic education and the joy of the gospel. In Montreal, some great women were instrumental in founding the city and helping the church to establish itself. I would like to bring to your attention two great figures, Jeanne Mance and Sainte Marguerite Bourgeois. Jeanne Mance is co-founder of the city of Montreal, along with Paul Chomedy de Maisonneuve. Jeanne Mance's life is being studied in Rome at the present time. She's on the road to beatification and sainthood. She was officially recognized as co-founder of Montreal 3 years ago. She was a laywoman, a French nurse who came to Montreal and founded l'Hôtel Dieu de Montréal, the hospital which exists to this day. And at one point, Jeanne Mance secured funds from France, saving the colony. You may know that the project of the foundation of Montreal was born in France by a group of Catholics who wanted to establish a Christian village in North America. That was their project. They dreamed about it, they prayed about it, they prepared and sent people to found, to establish this city. They named their village Ville Marie, Mary's City, and it was established on an island between Quebec and Urania, Montreal. At the heart of this audacious endeavor, Jérôme Le Royer de La Dauversière and his wife, who financed this project, Paul Chomedey de Maisonneuve, a soldier in his 30s who commanded the expedition, and Jeanne Mance, a nurse and volunteer, 34 years old. Ville Marie was born of a dream to bring natives and pious French settlers together to create a new people of God. After 10 years, Le Royer, who financed this project, was ruined and in bankruptcy. De Maisonneuve was recalled to France and died. Only Jeanne Mance stayed. She stayed on to serve the sick and accompany the poor. Ville Marie kept its name for about 20 years and then became the city we now know as Montreal. You know Montreal, don't you? There's a great hockey team there, by the way. But that's not part of my talk. Jeanne Mance was recognized by the church for her heroic virtues in 2014 by Pope Francis. A lay woman, a nurse, we can be very proud of. Another beautiful figure of Canada's rich history is Saint Marguerite Bourgeois, the foundress of the Congregation of Notre-Dame de Montréal. Born in France, she arrived in Canada, where she spent her life educating young girls, the poor and natives, until her death at the turn of the 18th century. She is also significant for developing the first uncloistered religious community in the Catholic Church. During her early years in Montreal, Marguerite Bourgeois did manage to make some significant initiatives. In 1657, she persuaded a work party to form in order to build Ville Marie's first permanent church, the Chapel of Our Lady of Good Counsel, l'Église Bon Secours. She was provided with a vacant stone stable by De Maisonneuve in 1658 that served as a schoolhouse for her students. This was the beginning of public schooling in Montreal, established only 5 years after Marguerite's arrival. She was declared a saint in 1982. Here is another trait that we need to remember when we look at the lives of the saints. The Lord calls them and prepares them for the mission they are about to receive and accomplish. But what makes a difference in the lives of these people who are recognized as saints is that not only do they hear God's call, but they are docile, available to let God lead them, and they are willing to obey and follow God's plan. And sometimes God's plan is surprising, not exactly what we expect. Here are a few examples. François de Laval was a young priest in France, preparing to go work as a missionary in Asia. He was destined to go to Vietnam. Lo and behold, he is appointed First Bishop of Quebec in North America, a land that is totally unfamiliar to him. He prepares himself and leaves for Quebec, where he will spend 50 years of his life, dying at a very old age at that time of 85 years old. The same goes for Marie de l'Incarnation. She experienced in her early years of her life some profound spiritual encounters with the Lord, mystical experiences. Then she married, became a mother, and rapidly a widow, and had to take over her husband's business that had gone bankrupt while raising as a single mother her son. When he was older, she entered the convent of the Ursuline nuns in France, hoping to finish her life in contemplation and in prayer. The Lord called her to become a missionary and leave her country to travel to Quebec. She obeyed, and because of that, her missionary spirit continues to inspire us today. Yesterday, we celebrated her feast day in our liturgy. Now, I could go on all night sharing with you the inspiring lives of the holy men and women that founded Canada. But I'd like to conclude by sharing a few thoughts that could inspire you to want to become a saint. What does it take to put you on the road to holiness? I find that St. Paul has some stimulating words in his letters, encouraging words for us today. In his letter to the Romans, who have come from paganism, he reminds them that by virtue of their call, they are incorporated into a loving relationship, constituted saints, consecrated to God. And I quote from the first chapter of Romans, verse 7, "To all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be his holy people, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ." He wrote that to the Romans, but this is the word of God. Today, it's for you and me. And to the Corinthians, he writes from the first letter, first chapter, verse 2, "To the church in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people, together with all those everywhere who call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and ours." Do you discover the key? Holiness is only possible for you and for me if we are in a relationship with Jesus Christ, who opens our hearts and our lives to a living relationship with the Father and the Holy Spirit. In St. Paul's teaching, it seems to me that there are three fundamental steps to becoming a saint, three steps to sanctification. One, a relationship that reveals that we belong to God. Baptism brings us into a covenant, a relationship with God. Plunged in the waters of baptism through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, that is the starting point. Could you, just by a show of hands, raise your hand if you've been baptized? You've got what it takes. Just continue. You've started. You're on the right road. That's where it starts, our relationship with the Lord, plunged in the Paschal mystery. This is the life-giving relationship we need to develop all the days of our life. And that is how we will spend eternity, in that loving relationship, in a loving relationship with the Lord. Pope Francis insists constantly on this aspect and invites us to renew our encounter with the Lord. In the first paragraphs of his apostolic exhortation, The Joy of the Gospel, we read, paragraph 3, if you want to look it up when you get home, and I quote Pope Francis, "I invite all Christians everywhere at this very moment to a renewed personal encounter with Jesus Christ, or at least an openness to letting him encounter them. I ask all of you to do this unfailingly each day. The Lord does not disappoint those who take this risk. Whenever we take a step towards Jesus, we come to realize that He's already there, waiting for us with open arms. Now is the time to say to Jesus, Lord, I have let myself be deceived. In a thousand ways, I have shunned your love. Yet here I am once more to renew my covenant with you. I need you. Save me once again. Lord, take me once more into your redeeming embrace. How good it feels to come back to him, writes Pope Francis, whenever we are lost. Let me say this once more. God never tires of forgiving us. We are the ones who tire of seeking his mercy. I saw you all raised your hands when I asked if you were baptized. Just by a show of hands, raise your hand if you've sinned in your life at least once. Do you see the Lord's attitude? Open arms to welcome us. Holiness is possible not only if we are baptized, but if we accept to come back to Him if we've gone astray, if we've made the wrong turns, if we've put Him in the co-pilot seat and driven our lives our own way. They say, I don't know, but they say the most popular song in hell is, I did it my way. That's not how we want to live. So the first and the most important step to be on the way of holiness is to have a relationship that reveals that we belong to God. Secondly, to strive for a life of integrity, loyalty, obedience, and fidelity to our loving God. This requires sincerity, a fundamental option to a life that strives for coherence, so that we can, as the popular saying goes, walk the talk. Pope Francis is also constantly challenging us, not just the faithful. Oftentimes he'll turn to the cardinals and to the bishops and to the priests and tell us, you need to be more coherent. You're not giving the testimony, the witnessing you should be. You're called to live out the gospel more fully. You're called to give an example so people will be attracted and come to Jesus Christ. Which reminds me of the story of the two identical twins that lived in a small city in Ontario. One was a priest and the other was a doctor. They were identical. The priest was the pastor of the little parish, and the other twin practiced medicine in the same city. Being identical twins, people would often mistake one for the other. The doctor was often very annoyed by this. One day, while the doctor was at the grocery store, someone came up to him and said, Father, may I have a word with you? With a rather serious response, he said, I am not the one you think I am. I'm not the one who preaches. I'm the one who practices. Which one are you? We can have both inside of us sometimes. St. Paul writes to the Corinthians, second letter, first chapter, verse 12. Now this is our boast. Our conscience testifies that we have been conducted ourselves in the world, and especially in our relations with you, with integrity and godly sincerity. We have done so, relying not on worldly wisdom, but on God's grace. In French, we say, it's a beautiful expression, it's difficult to translate, des croyants crédibles, credible believers. And thirdly, to continue on the road to holiness, if you really want to become a saint, it can't be a part-time job, a hobby. It requires the daily offering of all we are under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Again, here are some encouraging words from St. Paul to the newly converted Christians in Rome. Chapter 12, first verse. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. For this is God's will, he writes to the Thessalonians, your sanctification. God wants you to become a saint. He calls you to holiness. Are you up to the challenge? Why does God want that for you? Why does he want you to become a saint? Because holiness is a path to happiness. Saints are happy people because they are in a deep, loving relationship with God. And the Lord helps them discover who they are and what they are called to be and to become. Don't let your past, your history as a sinner, your mistakes, your wrong turns, frighten you or discourage you from undertaking this wonderful adventure. I love this phrase that I repeat often. I read it once in a book. It comes in two parts. The first part we know, but we forget the second part. The first part goes like this: God loves you just as you are. That's good. God loves you. He knows you. He knows everything about you. He loves you just as you are. Now be careful. Here comes the second part. God loves you just as you are, but he refuses to leave you like that. He refuses to leave you just as you are. He wants you to become a holy person with more freedom, with more light in your life, with more love, more truth. But don't get him wrong. He loves you. And when you love someone, you want them to become better. Remember also that every saint has a past. So many saints did not begin their lives as holy people. A few examples are the many people Jesus encounters in the gospel. Mary Magdalene, Peter, Paul, the good thief crucified next to Jesus on Good Friday. And how about St. Augustine and many others? All saints have a past as sinners. But what you need to remember is that all sinners have a future: holiness. So what do you need? What do you need to make it? You do not need, this will relieve you when I tell you this, you do not need an iPhone. You do not need an iPad or an iBook, not even the new iWatch. What you need if you're going to become a saint is an I love. I love God with all my heart and all my soul and with all my being. I love God because He loved me first. You need, I love my neighbors as Jesus loves them and gave His life for them. People who become saints are those who accept to love. I love. And that can only become a reality in your everyday life if you nourish your relationship with the Lord through prayer. A dialogue where you listen to Him and He listens to you, and slowly the loving relationship converts you, changes your mentality, changes the direction of your life, changes your heart to be more like Him, loving, caring, forgiving, joyful, truthful, just, filled with hope, and attentive to the poor and those who suffer around you. It can only grow on you and make you grow in holiness if you are fed by the Word of God and the bread of life. And I would say, if you want to take this calling seriously, you need to feed on the Word of God and on the Eucharist at least every Sunday, and if possible, on a daily basis. It can only continue to make you grow in love, in truth, and in freedom if you celebrate God's mercy in the sacrament of reconciliation. That is the secret of the saints. They were not perfect people, none of them. But they learned to open their hearts to God's love and mercy, and God always welcomed them to put them back up on their feet to continue with their lives and to be able to say, I love. The church in Canada continues to live out its mission of evangelization. So what do you say? Are you up to the challenge? Are you willing to answer God's call to holiness? We need saints to bring people to the fabulous encounter with Jesus Christ, who changes lives and helps people change the world. Many holy men and women in our history have contributed to this mission in powerful ways. They were ordinary people, when you take them one after each other. Ordinary people like you and me. But they opened themselves to the grace of God and to the Holy Spirit and accepted that God would be their guide and pilot. And look at all they accomplished. The Canadian church needs saints today to continue to evangelize this third millennium. Why not you? And why not me? Give it some thought, please. And most of all, give the Lord your answer soon. He's waiting. You'll discover what He's got planned for your life, and I bet it's going to be quite an adventure. Thank you.